the Bürgerville Workers Union. Its primary basis. The Bürgerville Workers Union is based on the workers, meaning the members of the workforce without the managers. Team leaders, store managers, and administrative workers are also excluded. This is partly because working conditions there are considered to be less burdensome. The secondary basis. The secondary base is Bürgerville's customers and other workers in low-wage sectors. Bürgerville's workers have attached great importance to working in alliances with other trade unions, non-profits and local faith communities, as broader support means stronger protection against dismissal. The opponent is the management of Bürgerville. The problems. Here are described the three biggest problems. Within the Bürgerville Workers Union, the three top problems were identified as low pay, the first one. The starting salary is based on the minimum wage in the state of Oregon, which is currently $9.75. Even if they have a longer contract, fellow workers as team leaders receive only $10.35. At the same time, for reasons that are not comprehensible to the fellow workers, individual workers are preferred so that they are already start with a salary of over $10. To what extent this payment is based on arbitrariness on the part of management or on discrimination according to gender, ethnicity cannot be understood in detail. The second one, lack of respect. The deconstructed and standardized work process, which should keep all fellow workers as interchangeable as possible and eradicate all creativity in the work process, is the starting point here. The result is both a standardization that should make every milkshake, burger, etc. look exactly the same and eradicate all small forms of creativity of the workers. In addition, there's a very high work density, which leads to a very high burden, and at the same time an attitude of the management that fellow workers who work there are either social losers or young people who only earn pocket money. Here, respect refers to the dehumanization in the work process, which makes the workers into appendages of the standardized work process.
So in the issue of Shakespeare, I think like that specifically like relates to social engineering in the factory context, because it de-skills your worker. You can't take any pride in the work you do, and so everything you do, it can't even feel like it could be fun. There is no, like, it takes away the humanity. It alienates the worker from what they're doing. Mm-hmm. And so if you put sprinkles on something, or if you make like a certain shape with the whipped cream, or if you do it in a certain way that customers prefer, something like that. That's wrong. You have to make it like a fucking fat, like as much of it as a robot as possible. And the less creativity or the less of you that you put into your work or anything, the better it is. And you get scorned if you try to make it better. If people compliment you for something that you did well or anything, they go, well, fuck you. You didn't do it exactly like the other 500. And even if it's better, we don't care. It makes the work that much more boring and burdensome. And it alienates workers from the work they do. And it's a terrible situation.
The interviewees also described that these successful techniques of social control of the company also contribute to the fact that there's a lot of joking about suicide among the workers, who themselves noticed that the high level of jokes about it could also indicate that there might be more truth in it than just stupid sayings. All in all, this part of the description in the interview took a long time. Probably also because all participants were actively organizing and the techniques were used in a very effective way by the company. As the last main problem, the interview partners mentioned inconsistent shift schedule. Some of the fellow workers at Bürgerville also have two or three jobs that have to be coordinated with each other. The lack of clarity about how many hours can be worked at what time, and also the late scheduling of shift makes it very difficult to reconcile these challenges. This problem also includes the fact that due to the high fluctuation caused by the high workload in the shops, at least one or two fellow workers quit their jobs every week. That means they are absent due to illness or have to be trained first. The top three advantages of membership. First, these included a network of workers and non-workers from Bürgerville. In the course of the campaign, the Bürgerville Workers Union was very concerned about allies, which in the opinion of the fellow workers also led to the fact that the inner circle was still not fired. In addition, there's a system for reacting quickly to changes. This is due to the high degree of networking and the decision-making structure of the Bürgerville Workers' Union, which estimates that problems repeatedly arise at the workplace that must be dealt collectively within a short response time. For this purpose, they have a committee as decision-making structure that is elected for 6 months and decides in such cases. Lastly, the fellow workers listed trade union advantages, such as the relatively greater legal protection against management action compared to when things are clearly marked as trade union action. The unique selling point. A simple, clear message explaining why we are different and why it's worthwhile to participate. The BVWU uses various slogans. However, the most commonly used slogan is, "We need a raise." This is followed by the motto, "We are the heart of Bürgerville," and the further slogan, "We deserve a voice." The strategies. Where do fights take place? How do we win? As strategies, the workers name direct actions at the company level, the building of workers' power within the company, and the establishment of a boycott. The latter refers to a secondary boycott by customers and or suppliers, the aim of which is to exert pressure on the company and also to harm it. The campaign went public on April 26, 2016, accompanied by a demonstration of about 150 supporters, including activists from political alliances, other trade unions, and people from various religious communities. A delegation went to the headquarters of Bürgerville and handed over their demands, while the demonstration moved to a central store in the city. What was remarkable about the campaign was that the company was taken by surprise by the approximately 1.5 years of preparatory work and was confronted with the workers.
Right. Yeah.
Tell managers and workers that they support the union. Right off the bat, right? So what they saw was like, that we went public and we had this like before that it kind of like what they saw was like this magic thing, yeah. You know, that we just like waved a wand.
Yeah.
IWW sections also have chosen similar actions in the past. The place of conflict is above all the shops themselves. The establishment of a boycott is promoted among the other things by the alliance work described above, as well as by establishing contacts with supplier companies in the region and by setting up the Solidarity Committee, which made the necessary contacts. The competitive advantage cannot simply be fought by an enemy actor or opponent. A competitive advantage that cannot be fought by an opponent or hostile actor was considered their actions unforeseeable by the company, in the form of direct actions. In addition, there are their political members who do not see their organizing as mere wage job, but as a political action, who accordingly also react collectively to management actions instead of coming to terms with the circumstances individually. In addition, they have several organizers who have not previously organized companies. This can be an advantage since the workers try out interventions and do not yet find themselves in routine procedures. On the other hand, this can also be a disadvantage because they might not be prepared for the counterattacks. As a third competitive advantage, the fellow workers named their social networks in the sense of an alliance work of community, churches, trade unions, etc. However, the Bürgerville Workers' Union also has comparatively great success on Facebook. Within a few of days of publication, more than 1,500 people followed the website. The costs. Long-term and short-term financing. In terms of financing, the Bürgerville Workers' Union owns its membership fees and those of the IWW. In addition, there are donations from the community and other unions. In this context, similar to the other two models examined, we can speak of a low-resource model. They are all supporters by volunteers who organize the union in their free time. The key indicators. Key activities that are measured. For the Burgerville Workers Union, one criteria is the number of trained leaders, the level of commitment, and the coverage in social media and other media. In addition, the number of union members and the results of actions are relevant for evaluation because they are used to assess whether workers' power has increased. Because through the higher number of organizers, they hope to have more participants in actions as well as a higher intensity of pressure on the company. The channels. Ways to reach members, allies, and the rest of the grassroots. The Burgerville Workers Union channels are primarily electronic communication, such as Facebook, newsletter programs like MailChimp, group messengers like GroupMe and WhatsApp, email and the cloud system Google Drive. Electronic communication is mainly used to exchange documents, assign tasks, and collect contact data. In addition, there are meetings and social events such as game nights, parties, etc., or one-on-one conversations among workers. Above all, social events are among the most important trade union activities since the level of isolation at the workplace is very high and joint organization is based on mutual trust and the agreement of contents and decisions. At the same time, it became clear to fellow workers that they must also always react quickly when individual fellow workers are attacked by bosses and quick help is needed. The core competencies. Three things we have to be world-class in. In this context, the first one is alliance work, which was mentioned above all, as the step into the public by the Burgerville Workers Union was accompanied by many journalists as well as fellow workers from local alliances and trade unions. In this context, media coverage was mentioned as a further core competence. The second one. It also played a greater role at the Starbucks Workers Union and Jimmy John's Workers Union. During the first weeks, there were radio, print, and newspaper interviews.
Mm-hmm. And in some places, it's just been a way of being like, you give workers shit, we're gonna give you shit. Mm-hmm. You know? Like, you can't just act with impunity. You can't just do whatever you want. Like, mm-hmm. we're watching, and we're, like, we're here, and we're gonna be responding, and we're gonna be defending workers. Like, even if we're not able to get that worker rehired, we're gonna, like, make it hurt. Because, like, that's not an okay thing that y'all just did.
Last, the third one is the direct involvement of workers, including quick reactions to management actions. Membership and multiplier structure. How do we define membership? How are decisions made? Which criteria define membership? What is the structure? Formal members of the Burgerville Workers Union are counted as members of the union, which consists of membership fees and the signing of authorization cards. The Burgerville Workers Union is structured through several committees. These include the General Membership, the Solidarity Committee, the Action Committee, the Organizing Committee, and the Internal Decision Makers, who are elected for 6 months. Members are elected to posts such as Secretary or Treasurer. The mechanisms. How are the conditions improved, improvements maintained? Members kept, how are successes linked to being a member? The concept of mechanism has so far been little discussed at the Burgerville Workers Union in this form. The fellow workers mainly mentioned the change of consciousness and inspiration of workers as well as continuous organizing. Also mentioned were the social relations and bonding among workers. The new category, techniques of domination and splitting management. In the stories of the interviewees, they described their jobs as very strenuous. Some participants described the job as the most exhausting job of their lives. The fact that this assessment is not an individual opinion is supported by the statistics, which show a fluctuation of 80% of the workforce within a calendar year. As far as the dimension of effort is concerned, the density of work processes plays just as much of a role as the dequalification of workers through standardization. It is described by fellow workers as a devaluation of their own labor, but also as dehumanization. They describe the process of standardization as an attempt to organize work processes in a kind of assembly line production. At the same time, there is an immense time pressure. One proof of this is the stop time in the drive-in, which is only a few seconds longer than the preparation time of individual menu items.
Other thing is speed of service. I don't think you need to mention speed of service. So like drive-through has a speed of service timer that starts immediately once the car pulls up to the menu. And you're expected to get from the time they pull up to the time they like pull away is 3.5 minutes. Which is fucking crazy because like a lot of the food takes 3.5 minutes to cook. And like a lot of times,
especially if it's not like rush, you know, if you're in the middle of like the morning or the afternoon or late at night, you're not holding halibut, you know, you're not holding, you know, chicken. You cook that when they order it, and that's like those things take 3 minutes and 15 seconds to cook, and they want you to then have it out the window in 15 more seconds. Not to mention if the car dawdles.
It was also reported that many fellow workers talk openly about suicidal thoughts so often that even the interviewees said it was more truthful if they joked about it so often. They interpret these thoughts as directly related to the working conditions and the resulting hopelessness, which became known in many conversations in connection with organizing. All in all, these statements were very similar to the slogan of fellow workers at Amazon, who, under the slogan, "We are not robots," resisted, above all, the rigid time management and tracking of all work processes. The fellow workers also mentioned that within the organization, all fantasy is tried to be driven out of the work process, exemplarily described by the attempted decoration of an ice cream for which the colleague was shouted at. The repression consisted of his boss shouting at him. In this context, many descriptions are conspicuously based on management techniques of system gastronomy, which belong to the state-of-the-art of management techniques. Another aspect is that the workers at Burgerville do not get the chance to get in contact with each other. There are no team meetings, but when regulations are introduced, all employees are called to an office to sign. At the same time, the workers are not allowed to talk to each other for at least 30 seconds. There is, therefore, a de facto ban on speaking. It was noticeable that the interview partners talked relatively much about the social techniques of management in relation to the length of the interview. Some of these techniques have already been described above under problems. The analytical separation of these techniques should not hide the fact that in practice they merge into a conglomerate, which makes the working day very stressful for the workers as a whole. Part B, successes and failures of the Burgerville Workers Union. The aim of the IWW campaigns is the immediate improvement of working conditions and the development of skills of involved workers in order to create a world based on needs in the long run. Criteria for success is the improvement of the conditions of struggle and living and the training of organizers. It could also be formulated in the language of critical psychology that the goal of the IWW is generalized capacity to act and campaigns must be measured by whether they have done so. The difficulty is to operationalize this, but at least successes and defeats can be presented. Overall, the evaluation of Burgerville Worker Union's successes and defeats proved difficult at the time of the interview. The visible successes, understood as the implementation of the demands of the Burgerville Workers Union by the management, can be found on a smaller level. In order to be able to write about successes nevertheless, one must distinguish between the union's catalogue of demands, which was handed over during the first action, and the small, everyday dispute in the store. The latter are no less important in practice because the defense of the daily attacks by management establishes a culture of resistance in which more workers feel inspired to defend themselves as well. This includes individual measures in situations where individual workers are shouted at or support in the event of accidents at work.
We didn't, like, I think a lot of the stuff we've done over the past 6 months has been like responding in like instances where workers get like unfairly fired or unfairly like disciplined or suspended, you know? So we've like done like fairly significant mobilizations when, you know, like when a worker got fired at your store for, you know, accidentally breaking a sink after he burned himself. And we did like mobilizations at y'all's store when a worker got like accused of stealing and then like, you know, manipulated into quitting. And we like did a action when a worker at my store, when a manager wouldn't let his coworker go home even though he was like sick and felt like he was gonna like pass out and shit. So stuff like that. And I think in some cases we've like won in those like sort of mini campaigns or whatever, like those responses.
However, there are also individual cases in which carpets were enforced for the fellow workers, as they would otherwise have to work on cold concrete floors all day long. Among these interviewees, this was seen as an important achievement in occupational health and safety. On the other hand, Burgerville refuses to acknowledge the existence of the Burgerville Workers Union and to negotiate with them. In addition, the interviewees reported how they would like to meet more people at the union meetings. Another problem was reported by one colleague in front of whose store the demonstration took place on April 26, 2016. She reported that for the employees, the demonstration and the public put a lot of pressure on them, although they all knew about the action beforehand. At the same time, this created a lot of pressure on the management in the store.
Because like, you know, my store, the 150 person rally was at my store, and I think we did an amazing job with it. You know, I think like logistically and organizationally it was like exactly how we planned, but I think for my coworkers, you know, it didn't follow the sort of like escalation plan of like step one, step two, step three. Like it was sort of like 0 to 100, and I think that was like a little like shocking, even though like my coworkers, you know, 90% of them knew it was gonna happen. We had had one-on-ones and like prepared people. I think it also like opened up my store in particular for a lot of pressure from corporate on our managers, and our managers then put a lot of pressure on workers. And I think it created pretty immediately a pretty like tense and sometimes hostile environment where like being part of the union like became like a really controversial thing. Whereas like the going public rally at other stores like opened up a lot of space, you know, where people were like, oh, this is so exciting, like I saw the video, I saw the pictures, like I want to do this, I want to be involved, you know, like a convention center. Like post going public, shit like blossomed, you know? Shit at your store too, you know, just like all the space, shit at Mark's store, like all the space and opened up, like we got a lot of new people, people were really excited, there was a lot of energy. Whereas my store was really strong pre-public, and then having shit going public happened. And I don't regret it, you know, but I do think, like, I see the effect, I live the effect, the brutal effect of, like, the way that happened, you know. So I think that's something which, like, if I go back in time, maybe, like, I think maybe there are things that we could have done differently. But again, like, I also see, like, the incredible, like, important role that action played at other stores, you know, so...
A further assessment of the successes and failures was unfortunately not possible at the time of the interview.